Ahibai, you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the glorious Quran mentions for us passages from the times of the previous Anbiya. And the idea or the wisdom behind these passages is that man is able to take lesson and to refine his behavior, number one, because history repeats itself. Number two, to not make the same mistakes as those who failed in the lives and in the times before us. And you find that within this bab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in numerous places within the Holy Quran, speaks about the prophethood of Nabiullah Nuh. And you find that the dhikr of Nabiullah Nuh within the Quran is highlighted in a very particular manner. And there are certain khususiyat that are attributed and that are khas, khususiyat that are attached to Nabiullah Nuh. And from this khususiyat, you will find that there is the dhikr of Nabiullah Nuh when it comes to the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada, which is why in Ziyarat al-Waritha, which you perhaps have already recited or you will recite on a night like this, you refer and you address Imam al-Husayn. You salute Sayyid al-Shuhada by saying, As-salamu alayka ya waritha Nuhin Nabiullah. For you find that understanding the risala of Nabiullah Nuh is a key part for us to understand the risala and the reason for the uprising of Imam al-Husayn in the blessed lands of Karbala. This land of Karbala which has absolutely no equal. This Imam al-Husayn who has no parallel whatsoever. La yawm ka yawmika ya Aba Abdullah. There is no day like Ashura. Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba signed the seal over here. In any way, for you find that for the path of our lecture today, there is one particular aspect of the Nabuwa of Nabi Nuh that I would like to touch upon. And there is a particular sifat that we would like to identify and see how this character then was passed on or existed across the passage of time and what the impact of this was during the time of Imam al-Husayn on the day of Ashura. You find that if you were to summarize the advent of Nabiullah Nuh from within the verses of the Holy Quran, Nabi Nuh preached for a period of 950 years. And from within the hadith of Ahlul Bayt, you find that he lived for close to 2,500 years, of which 950 of them he spent inviting the people towards the message of Allah Azza wa Jal. And you find that within the books of Ahlul Bayt or within the literature of Ahlul Bayt, that during the time of this grand tufan, this global flood that swept through the entire dunya, bayn al-Qawsain, between brackets, this flood started inside of Masjid al-Kufa. Nabiullah Nuh built his ark outside of Masjid al-Kufa, which is why when people would come and they would look at Nabi Nuh, they would laugh at him and they would mock him and they would say, this old man has lost his sanity. He's building an ark and building a ship when we are in the middle of a desert. Nabiullah Nuh, upon building the ark, after 950 years of risala, warns the people of this global adab which is coming. Do you know how many people embarked the ark of Nabiullah Nuh? According to hadith of Ahlul Bayt, the number of people in that ark are the same number of the companions of Imam al-Husayn. 72 men boarded the ark of Nabi Nuh. 72 men stood together with Imam al-Husayn as major generals from day one. And you think over here, mahall al-ta'ammul. It is absolutely critical and crucial for each and every one of us as lovers of Imam al-Husayn, as Mawalis, as Shi'is, as Husaynis, as intellectuals scholars within the religion, ambassadors, because each and every one of you in your own capacity is an ambassador to Imam al-Hussein. It is important for us to ask ourselves, what was there in the message of Nabiullah Nuh, which attracted so much opposition, such that after 950 years of tabligh and risala, only 72 men accepted the message and hence boarded the ark. What was so critical about the message of Nabi Nuh? Did the concept of tawheed in that, Ya Bani Adam, believe in one Allah, this concept of tawheed, that the Lord of the universe and the creator of everything within the realm of existence is one, and this one cannot be captured by the senses, by the human senses, and cannot be perceived by any physical constraint. Truly, was this concept so difficult for people to understand at that time? Shunu, what was the reason for this opposition towards Nabiullah Nuh? Such that they were willing to drown, but they would not board that ark. You find that the Quran addresses this. And the Quran addresses a number of reasons why the people rejected the message of Nabi Allah Nuh. Yes, there were those who fought and were a formidable opposition when it came to the concept of Tawheed. But there were other underlying layers that are associated to Tawheed for which they bore opposition. You find that the Quran highlights this reason of opposition towards Nabiullah Nuh in Surah Ash-Shu'ara, verse number 111, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Qalu, the people who lived at the time of Nabi Nuh and rejected his message, as Nabiullah would invite them and call them towards Tawheed, they said, Qalu, Anu'minu laka wattaba'aka al-ardhaluna. They would come to Nabiullah Nuh and they would say to him, do you really want us to submit to your religion, to be a part of your religion, when only, quote unquote, when only the poor class of the society follow you? So from here we understand from the verse of the Holy Quran that one of the founding reasons why people bore enmity or bore opposition towards Nabiullah Nuh is that there was a great part of that community that considered themselves to be from the elite class. Because of their race, because of their ethnicity, because of their wealth, because of their materialistic dunyawi gains or their dunyawi affiliations, they felt that we are way too high of a class than to mingle with the lowest class of society that is following Nabi Nuh. And you find that when you delve deeper into the tafsir of this ayah, you actually had parts of the community who were from the elite, the so-called elite, who would come to Nabi Nuh and they tried to broker a deal. You get somewhere or how you have these groups of negotiators. They come and they want to negotiate to Nabiullah Nuh, negotiate the terms and conditions of what our religion will be. This is, if we have A, B, C, D, we will follow the deen. This is a deen, very good. E, F, G, we don't really like it. You find the remnants of this thought process even in this day and age. For you find, they came to Nabiullah Nuh and they said to him, message of Tawheed, message of charity, message of goodness, one God, we are ready to follow you. But on the condition that you will free this religion of the lower class people, the sick, the disabled, the jobless, the homeless, those who have not made it anywhere, kindly remove them from the religion because we are a class much higher. And Nabiullah Nuh would say to them, How do you want me? How do you expect my Lord to turn them away when they were the first ones to believe with all sincerity in the oneness of that Creator? And you find that this insistence of having segregation by class, segregation by wealth, creating artificial social barriers within the community became one of the major reasons why they rejected Tawheed as a concept. For as you delve deeper into the tafsir of the Quran, you find that the people of the times were not really opposed on its own to the concept of the oneness of God. It was the consequences and the laws and the regulations of how we should live life. Once you submit to that tawheed, this is where the ishkal was. And they refused. They would rather drown to death then sit side by side on an ark of salvation with somebody of a lower class. Shket ajib Bani Adam can become. This, my brothers and sisters, the root of all evil, having superiority complex within you because of artificial dunyawi gains that we think are the separators between us and the rest of mankind. And you find this trait continues within Bani Adam, the superiority complex, this ego that exists within man. You find that this trait continues across the passage of time throughout Bani Adam during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. You find what was one of the founding reasons for Abu Sufyan's opposition towards Islam during the Meccan period. If you were to read through early Meccan history, when Rasulullah came with the message, "Kulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu," submit to the shahada of la ilaha illallah and you shall have success for the dunya and the akhirah. Refer back to Islamic history. Did they doubt in the credibility of Rasulullah? No, he was known as Amin Sadiq and Amin even before the Risala. In fact, he was known to be one of the most dignified youth of Arabia, such that when the Hajar al-Aswad was displaced and they didn't know which tribe should put the Hajar al-Aswad back, and a civil war was about to break out between these Badawi tribes of Hijaz, Rasulullah came as the negotiator to make peace in a city or in an area where people didn't understand the meaning of peace. All of this before Risala. They had no doubt in his sharaf. Abu Sufyan's major opposition towards Rasulullah was what during the early Meccan days? He would come to Imam Abu Talib and he would say to him, "Oh Abu Talib, tell your nephew that this religion is not acceptable to us. Does Muhammad think that the Quraysh, leaders of Quraysh, are equivalent to the African slaves? We reject this religion on the basis of equality." Abadan la. They were insistent on this segregation by class and this social hierarchy of artificial authority because it served their personal interests. And they opposed Rasulullah bitterly towards this. You find that this ego, in its evil nature, in its toxic nature, becomes even more toxic. Having ego or suffering from this superiority complex is an evil trait to begin with. In fact, if you analyze this concept through the literature of Ahlul Bayt and tie it to contemporary terms, it falls under a category of mental health issues. Because it comes with insecurity, it comes with a whole bunch of things. It's a kalam for a different lecture. In any case, this spiritual, this disease of ego, spiritual disease, mental disease, becomes more toxic when a person is not able to tame this beast within him when he enters into the realm of religion. So to wear the garbs of a religious person, to act as a religious person, to be in the position of a religious person and not have contained this beast of an ego, this toxicity, whatever that word term is, rises to a higher level. The poison becomes more severe when a person portrays egoistic behavior in the name of religion. You have, again, during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah was sitting in Masjid al-Nabawi. And it is so important that we become more and more familiar with our seerah of Rasulullah. You find that there is a war against the true personality of Rasulullah. He has been subject to character assassination throughout history. And you find that even in present-day Hijaz, whatever little remembrance there was of Rasulullah, even that is destroyed. If you and I don't keep alive the history of Rasulullah, and on that side, they are demolishing everything to do with the architecture and the archaeology and the history of Rasulullah, which prophet are we going to show for the future generations? Which prophet do we ourselves understand? In any case, Rasulullah was seated in Masjid al-Nabawi. And Rasulullah had a habit that whenever he delivered a khutbah or whenever Rasulullah would have discussions with his companions, Rasulullah would sit down on the ground with them, on the earth. Masjid al-Nabawi at that time was of sand and pebble. There was no carpets or anything of the sort. Rasulullah, out of his humbleness, would sit with the companions and he would emphasize that when we sit in Masjid al-Nabawi, we sit in a circle. Because when you sit in a circle, there is an element that everybody is equal. Do not sit in straight lines that go all the way, such that the person sitting all the way at the end feels he's the furthest from Rasulullah. They would sit in a circle. Hadith goes on to say that when Rasulullah would speak to people and they are sitting in this circle, even the eye contact that Rasulullah would have with each and every person sitting in the halaqa, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, even the amount of eye contact that Rasulullah would have for each and every person was equal. Meaning if they sat for 1 hour and there were 60 people, each person has got an equal share of the eye contact from Rasulullah. Such that the historians mentioned, the companions themselves would say, when we sat in the halaqa of Rasulullah, it was as if Rasulullah was talking to us one-on-one personally. He would sit with them. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajjal faraja. Characters, sarahatan, you read the seerah of Rasulullah, bas bishart. Read him from the texts and the books of Ahlul Bayt. You will fall in love with him. Because he's a manifestation of the mercy of Allah. And who does not fall in love when they are encompassed in an environment of mercy? Which is why we begin every verse of the Quran with Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. The minute you enter into the realm of the mercy of Allah, you are in love with Allah. And the journey of worship becomes or begins with love. Don't find in the verse of the Quran, Bismillahil Jabbar Shadidul Iqab. You have this? Abadan la. So Rasulullah would sit with them in the halaqa. And one of the days, as they were sitting, one of the companions, Sahabi from Quraysh, came and he was seated within the halaqa. And he was from what was considered to be the upper class of the day. And as he was seated, another Arab came into Masjid al-Nabawi. And what seems apparent from the narrations is that he was probably a herder. So who would deal with the animals in the far ends of the deserts and so on and so forth. He came and he sat and joined the halaqa. And there were apparent signs of poverty, whether his hair was disheveled, whether he didn't have the best of body hygiene or his clothes were torn, it was apparent. He came and he sat in the halaqa after asking the permission of Rasulullah, seated in a circle. As he sat next to this Qurayshi, this person who had this expensive abba just kind of moved it, as if to say, don't touch my clothes. Shabab, try and keep this, try and relate to this in our day and age. Sometimes aib, just because, for example, I'm wearing a Louis Vuitton outfit, that I'm going to mock somebody who shops at a Primark or at a Walmart. Perhaps this Abul Walmart's du'as are mustajab in front of Allah 100 times faster than mine and your du'a. Sahih Lola? How shallow has man become if we judge people based on the labels that are on their clothes? How shallow man has reached. And we're supposed to be at the peak of intellectualism and spirituality and everything. Sahil Allah, or I live in a different world. Salu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Tayyib, this person came and he moved his abba. Rasulullah noticed this. And they have within the seerah of Rasulullah that when he would get upset, his complexion would change. His face would turn red very quickly. So even if he didn't say anything, he didn't have to shout to express the fact that he's angry or upset. Within his silence, his face would turn absolutely red. And Rasulullah had a vein that would run through the center of his forehead or at his temples. And these veins would bulge out when he was absolutely angry in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they noticed this, they said, Ya Rasulullah, shufu, akhlaq tells us that when you want to guide somebody or you want to correct somebody, correct them in private. Sahih Lola, if you see somebody, don't correct them in front of everybody because you may embarrass them. So out of akhlaq, we say if you want to do one of the protocols of Amr bin Ma'ruf, Nahi anil Munkar, is that when you want to provide guidance towards somebody, you want to correct somebody's mistake with all the other conditions that are there, you take him into private and you speak to him, lest you break his moral confidence or social confidence and don't embarrass him in front of everyone. And you would find that Rasulullah should be at the top of akhlaq. Is there anyone greater in their akhlaq other than Rasulullah? Abadan la. But in this issue, the crime of feeling that you are most superior and showing any form of racist behavior towards your fellow Muslim brothers is a sin so grave in the eyes of Allah and the Prophet, Rasulullah decided to reprimand and to discipline him in public in front of everyone. This is how grave the sin was. So when he moved himself, Rasulullah was overcome with anger and he said to him, Fulan, he didn't say Fulan, I'm saying Fulan, said, Fulan, do you think that when this person came and sat next to you, if he touched your garment, that his poverty would affect you in your life? Did you think you have become much more elevated in the eyes of Allah because of your wealth, such that if he was to touch you, he would make you impure? Allah. This person was absolutely ashamed. Because Rasulullah is rebuking him in public to show you the grandness, the intensity, and the magnitude of this sin. Ego, superiority complex, because of his wealth or status. Straight away, the man was embarrassed and apologized. Rasulullah said, don't apologize to me. Sahih, the Quran says when you seek forgiveness, go to Rasulullah, ask for forgiveness, and then Allah will forgive you. But he sought forgiveness from Rasulullah, but Rasulullah says to him, seek forgiveness from this man. Subhanallah, this farmer or this shepherd who's come from the Badia sat in the halaqah not giving two thoughts to anything. He didn't feel intimidated that, oh, I should move. La. Confidence doesn't come from wealth. Confidence doesn't come from materialistic possessions. Confidence comes because of your iman in Allah and faith in Rasulullah. Hence he was seated there, didn't give anything about this guy. He likes to sit next to me, he doesn't like to sit next to me. Ani, I've come to the house of Allah, took the permission of Rasulullah, and I'm seated. He was unaffected. Somebody like me, if it happened to me, I'd be offended. I would probably throw a tantrum inside. When Rasulullah was rebuking him, I would take the opportunity to add more kerosene into the lighting fire. Sahlola. Seated there. You know what this feeling is? This is a person who has reached a level of itmi'nan and sukoon. Something that very rarely exists in this day and age. Sukoon of the heart, particularly during times of turbulence. Seated there. Rasulullah says, seek an apology from him. He says, oh man, forgive me. I did this out of ghafla, I was not thinking, made an excuse, whatnot. He said, forgive me. The man said, I forgive you. The person felt so guilty, the Quraishi felt so guilty. He said to him, my brother in Islam, because of the way that I have offended you and the gravity of the sin in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I would like to give you half of my wealth as a token of an apology. Forgive me. A man smiled at him and he said, no, thank you. Shufu ajib. No, thank you. Said to him, why? This is half my wealth, and it seems that you are in poverty. You're struggling in your day to day. The man's reply to him in front of Rasulullah and the rest of the companions was that I fear that if I take from your wealth, I may inherit some of your ego and superiority complex. A purity of the heart and the preservation of the purity of the heart is the most precious thing that you and I can own. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajil faraju. Abai, we're talking over here from the maqam of ego and superiority complex. Otherwise, Islam has absolutely no qualms with seeking wealth. Abadan la. In fact, this deen is built and this deen encourages each and every one of us, Matamis, Husseinis, to have reached the highest level of our worldly accomplishments. Rasulullah never willed for this ummah to be an ummah of fuqara and an ummah that is uneducated and underachieved. Abadan la. But don't let these worldly achievements deceive you into thinking that you have the right to exercise superiority or exercise an egoistic behavior in front of your fellow human being. There's a stark difference between these two. And you find that this character of this uncontrolled ego, which is the root of all evil, like the way it existed during the time of Nabiullah Nuh, passed down the generations of Bani Adam to Rasulullah, Ahibba is saddikuni, the same behavior and the same traits, if uncontrolled, will then be the basis of a formidable opposition against Imam al-Hujjah when his dhuhr happens. Do you know, within our texts, hadith from Ahlul Bayt, hadith that is mu'tabar, that Imam al-Hujjah himself will face an intense dissension, opposition, and rebellion from those who claimed and called themselves Shias in the ghaibah of the Imam. A high number of them will have been at scholarly levels, and they will have congregated from all different parts of the world in the city of Kufa, because they have this conference going on to see what their role and what to receive the revolution of Imam al-Hujjah. If we have a chance, inshallah, we'll discuss this in further detail. But there are those who will oppose Imam al-Hujjah based on the elements of reform that Imam al-Hujjah wants to implement. And the seerah of our 12th Imam is a reflection of the seerah of Rasulullah. And one of them is equality between different human beings. The minute they come into the fold of Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, Ashhadu anna Aliyan Amir al-Mu'minin, Aliyan Waliyullah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Find that finished. Class, sect, ethnicity, wealth suddenly becomes immaterial, becomes irrelevant. Your history becomes irrelevant. One of the ulama, Najaf al-Ashraf, in this Shahr Ramadan that just passed, within his bahath or his discussions he would have, he would say into him, and this was direction not only for the students who were there in the Hawza, but towards the armed, the general public. He would say, when the dhuhur of the Imam happens, and people are going to flock the religion from every part of the world, a manifestation and an actualization of this verse, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحَ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجَ. From every corner of the earth and the globe, people will enter under the imamate of Imam al-Mahdi, under the flag of Tawheed. He says, enter, are you ready? Look at the world around you today. Think about that homeless person who is down the street. Look at those individuals who are currently involved in some of the most undignified work, undignified professions, maybe even immoral professions, because of whatever reason, dhuruf. But when the nur of the Imam comes, and they see hope, and they see salvation, and they come running and pledge bay'ah to Imam, enter, you are willing to take them to be your equals. Take it a step forward. Imam selects this person to be above you when it comes to servitude within that global government. Is our nafs disciplined enough to accept that authority? Because during the time of Amirul Mu'mineen, Zubair was one of the people who was in the house with Amirul Mu'mineen after Saqifah. Defended Amirul Mu'mineen before the house of Sayyidat Nisa al-Alamin was burnt. Shufu, his end result was what? He waged war against Amirul Mu'mineen in the Battle of Jamal. Leish, why? Why? He felt that he was more elite than the rest of the Mu'mins when it came to receiving a stipend from the Baytul Mal. We are the ones who saw Rasulullah, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. We are the ones who stayed with you in the house during Saqifa. We are the ones who formed the formidable opposition. And now when government is in your hands, we get the same salary, the same stipend, the same respect as that non-Arab who just joined the deen the other day. Amir al-Mu'mineen, justice is justice. They waged war against him. And this is the same thing that we need to think. This is a religion. Deen is governed by akhlaq, and the fundamentals of akhlaq is to tame the ego within us. And there is no greater avenue in the history of creation where you would see the reality of an ego-free, if you could use this word, ego-free environment outside of Karbala. Do you know Karbala? Each and every one of these 72 companions, if you look at their sifat, what characters did they possess such that they ended up attaining this level of success. From all the characteristics that they possessed, uncompromising loyalty towards Ahlul Bayt on one hand. Do you know one trait that they had? Is that they demolished the faculty of ego from their existence. Ego. I give you two quick examples and we'll enter into Masaib. Number one, Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. Shufu wa antum, think about this. Hur repented on the day of Ashura. Is actually responsible for escorting Imam al-Hussein from the road between Makkah and Kufa all the way to Karbala. And from the day that they reached Karbala, 2nd of Muharram, until Yawm al-Ashur, Hur was over there. Hur performs tawbah and repents from Imam al-Hussein on the day of Ashura. What does Imam al-Hussein do? Imam al-Hussein forgives him. Sahih lola, we all know this. Did you ever think about the fact that, yes, Imam al-Hussein forgave him, but what was Hur's relationship with the other 71 or 72 companions of Imam al-Hussein? You will not find in the Maqtal that Habib ibn Madahir or Muslim ibn Awsaja went to Hur and said, you know what, it's not fair. You are the reason that we are hungry and thirsty for 3 days over here. It is because of you that we got under siege in Karbala. Did you find any of that? No superiority complex, no ego whatsoever. They hugged and they embraced each other to the extent that Hur and Zuhair ibn al-Kain on numerous times on the day of Ashura went on a dual battle and attacked the enemies, each one covering each other's back. There was no element of ego. They didn't go to Imam al-Hussein and they say, Ya Aba Abdullah, he's been drinking water and he had access to food for the last 9 days. Now that he's injured in the battlefield, why should he get the handkerchief of Sayyidati Nisa al-Alameen? Why not somebody like Muslim ibn Awsaja who has suffered with you throughout? Or Joan? There was no ego. The minute he came under the tent of Imam al-Hussein, it was as if they have always been one since the beginning of time. This love of Imam al-Hussein governed the relationship between these men to such an extent that love was so powerful for Imam al-Hussein that it just eradicated any remnants of ego or superiority complex within them. It's the love of Imam al-Hussein. When it fills your heart, finished. You begin to love everyone who loves Imam al-Hussein. And the same thing when it came to Hur. Do you know Hur bin al-Qusayn? Hur came from a family that was known for its military service, at least across the last three generations. From his grandfather to his father to himself. These are families that served in the army. That's what we would say in this day and age. These are families that have grown up in an environment of war. Men who have served in the army their entire lives. Hur not only served in the army, he was one of the most respected generals that existed or that lived during that time. A man who used to lead battalions of the thousand and would create strategy for war and would call the shots and lead men towards victory. This person who was a leader, do you know on the day of Ashura, where Imam al-Hussein placed him? Imam al-Hussein placed him to fight under the commandment and under the leadership of Habib ibn Madahir. A man who's been a leader in the war front, a general of some of the most powerful armies the world has seen during the time. Humbly, no ego, went and took his position as a foot soldier under the leadership of Habib ibn Madahir. Think about this. Ashura, these men had eliminated anything and everything to do with ego within their hearts. Hur could have gone to Imam al-Hussein and said, Ya Aba Abdullah, with all due respect, I've got a history. Why should I fight under Habib? And this trait of living a life without an ego began from the master himself, Imam al-Hussein. Imam al-Hussein had absolutely nothing to do. There was no element of segregation by class. My time is finished. We should be finishing the majlis in a few minutes with masa'ib. I say this to enter into the masa'ib. Do you know one of the companions of Imam al-Hussein was a Turkish slave? And perhaps we will speak more about him tomorrow so we can not have to cut short the masa'ib. He was a Turkish slave. And the circumstances of the time were such that if you had a Turk who was purchased as a slave in the Middle East, he would not have any human right to begin with. They would be treated worse than the camels that the Arabs would ride. And you can probably get a glimpse of this when you see how people from the subcontinent under work permits are treated within the Middle East. Sahilola, you get the hints of this. They would treat these Turks worse than the camels that they would ride. When he became Shaheed, Imam al-Hussein went running to him. His Turkish slave was called Aslam. And they call him in the Maqtal Aslam al-Turki. Imam al-Hussein went running towards him. He was taking his final breaths. This is your Mawla. You know what Imam al-Hussein did? He saw the body and this Shaheed taking his final breaths, struggling to breathe. Imam al-Hussein lay down on the sands of Karbala next to him, hugged him, i'tanakahu. Imam al-Hussein put his cheeks on the cheeks of this Turkish slave. Aslam opened his eyes and he said, who is like me? That Sayyid Shabab Ahl al-Jannah has put his cheek on my cheek. He said this and his ruh left his body. Ahibai. We learn to destroy the ego from Imam al-Hussein. Laylatul Jum'ah, Laylat Masaib of Imam al-Hussein. And the 10th after Ashura, Ahibba'i, Yawm Ashura was a day of great difficulty for Imam al-Hussein. A day of great trial and tribulation. From the Fajr until Asr, every moment of the day of Ashura was difficult for Imam al-Hussein. Sheikh Mahdi Mazandarani mentions that from all the difficulties Sayyid al-Shuhada experienced on the day of Ashura, there were three times where Imam al-Hussein heard the cry from the Maidan. The pain in the cry was such that the Rawi mentions the pain from the Maidan, the pain in the cry from the Maidan was such that when Imam al-Hussein heard this, Imam al-Hussein almost died out of grief. Allah, shalom. From these three, I will mention for you two. The Rawi mentions the first call that came from the Maidan was the call of Shah Qasim. Allah, Allah. When Shah Qasim called out to Imam al-Hussein from the Maidan, the pain in the cry of Shah Qasim was such that when Imam al-Hussein heard Qasim cry out, it affected him so much. Imam al-Hussein's ruh was about to come out from the body. The narrations mention that when the enemy struck Shah Qasim at the back of his head with a sword, the intensity of the strike was such Qasim fell down on the plains of Karbala face first. As he fell down on the plains, see, a number of the shuhada, when they fell out, they would cry out, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. But Qasim, the manner in which he was hit, the strike was so intense, he cried out, Adrikni ya Amma. help me, oh my uncle. So when Imam al-Hussein heard the cry of his nephew and he heard the pain in that cry, Adrikni Allah, Imam al-Hussein went charging towards the Maidan. The enemies from the east are running to the west. The enemies from the west are running to the east. In the middle is the body of Qasim. Do not ask me how many bones were trampled in the body of Qasim. But the Maqtal mentions that when the dust settled down, Imam al-Hussein was sitting at the head of Qasim. Qasim was moving his broken legs up and down out of pain. Imam al-Hussein says to him, Wallah, he says, I swear by Allah, Ya'izzu ala ammik, antad'uhu fala yujibuk. My son Qasim, it hurts me, it pains me that you call out to me and I was unable to come in time. That cry of Qasim almost killed Imam al-Hussein in the Khaymaga. Allah, Allah, Ya Shia Ta'ala Muhammad. The second cry from the Maidan, where the Rawi says Imam al-Hussein almost died out of grief, is when his son Aliyun al-Akbar was in the Maidan. Allah, Allah, Ya Shia, take your hearts to Karbala. Huh? It is as if you were sitting by the feet of Aliyun al-Akbar on this Thursday night in Karbala. Allah, the narrations mention that when they attacked Aliyun al-Akbar and he fell from his horse, he cried out from the other end of the Maidan, Alayka minni salam ya abata. The Rawi mentions when Imam al-Hussein heard the pain in the cry of Aliyun al-Akbar, he came out running off the Khaymaga. Sayyida Sukaina comes out, she says, Baba, why are you running from the Khaymaga? He says, I heard the cry of my Ali. Sukaina says to him, oh my father, the call came from that side. You are running in the opposite direction. Imam al-Hussein says, Sukaina, don't blame me. With the pain in the cry of Aliyun al-Akbar, I have lost my vision. Awa Imama, Allah, Allah. Eva, don't ask me how Imam al-Hussein reached at the body of Aliyun al-Akbar. The Maqtal says, Fakatta'uhu irban irba. They had cut Aliyun al-Akbar to pieces. Matame Hussein.
Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein,